Welcome to today's Leading Minds by London Business School, and I'm your master of ceremony for today. I'm Xing Zheming from CCTV News, the English service channel from China Central Television, now closed circuit TV. I'm very delighted to be here as a moderator for a later session panel discussion, and this is the very first time that the Leading Minds events are hosted here in Beijing, and a warm welcome to all of you guys. Thank you so much for attending. And we will start with a very warm welcoming speech by our dear Dean, Sir Andrew Lickerman. He will give us a warm welcome speech. Let's give a round of applause. Welcome.
Thank you very much. I promise to be warm. No problem on that. Thank you very much indeed for the introduction. I'm delighted we're here in Beijing for this Leading Minds event. I must tell you, it's always exciting to come to China. Things change all the time. The one thing that never changes is the traffic. The traffic never changes, and indeed the position of the cars never seems to change either. Can I offer also an extremely warm welcome to those from our executive MBA course here in Beijing for the week. I think it's fantastic that we're able to make this as part of the program and to incorporate this as part of the learning experience of an executive MBA. We talk about the importance of a global experience, and indeed being here in Beijing is a manifestation of just that. But just let me be clear about why China is so important as far as we're concerned. First of all, as a global business school, we don't believe it's possible to be involved in the 21st century without understanding and being part of the China story. For us, this is an essential part of the way the world is, and the a key important player in that world. I've used the expression before that one used to think that when America sneezed, the rest of the world caught a cold. It's now true, I think, and we've seen it, that if China sneezes, the rest of the world catches a cold. And therefore, what happens here has very widespread implications of the way the world economy operates. And similarly, it's China's growth rate and China's dynamism that for many years has fueled a lot of the macroeconomic aspects of the way the world has operated. So that's one reason. The second reason is that many of our students come from China and will come back and are coming and have come back to China. And we are very proud of the fact that we want to make our contribution to the China story by students coming here and playing their part in the development of the country. The third reason is that there are many things going on here as far as we're concerned, not just, for example, today's executive MBA program here. We have programs also spending time in Shanghai, in Hong Kong, in Shenzhen. We have, around the country, we are interested in people coming here to experience for themselves what goes on here in China. We have a joint program with Fudan in Shanghai, and we have many collaborative links with other business schools in other parts of China. So that, again, as a school, we have many links. I'm also delighted that we have a particular association with the State Administration of Foreign Exchange, and I'm delighted that some people are here this evening from SAFE. They come on our Masters in Finance program, and again, that's a close link which we very much value. So in all those kinds of ways, we have links in the way we do our business. But also, about half of what we do at the London Business School is to do with executive education. And we not only find that many people come from China on our executive education programs, but also we bring executive education programs here to China. People are interested in what's going on here, and an essential part of that learning process for executives, not just degree programs, is to be in China. So that just gives you an indication of our commitment, as it were, to the region and our involvement in it. I'd like now, just if I may, to turn to our guest speaker. I'm delighted that my colleague Richard Portes is here this evening. Richard is a world-renowned authority in macroeconomics and finance. He's been involved in international currencies. in financial regulation and the integration of national economies. And he's spoken widely about the renminbi, including in Shanghai and here previously in Beijing. So it's a delight to have you here, Richard. I should just say that Richard, unfortunately, has hurt his back. And so I know he's going to try and stand during this, Richard, but if you have to sit, I'm just explaining on his behalf. I mean, if you have to sit down, Richard, we understand. We can also hear you sitting down. Anyway, thank you very much indeed for everybody for coming this evening, and I hope you have an enjoyable time. Thank you.
Thank you for the stage. Sure. And now another round of applause for Professor Richard Portes.
So, okay. Well, I'll take this up here. Very good. Well, thank you very much, Andrew, for those kind words. And I will indeed try to stand up while I'm speaking. I feel much more comfortable doing that, but I may have to sit down. So we'll see. I first started to work, but no, sorry, I wanted to say, I agreed with 99% of what Andrew Lickerman has just said, but there's a 1% there that I don't find totally convincing, that the traffic in Beijing never changes. I first came here in 1985. There was a lot of traffic, of course, millions of bicycles. You just got into bicycle traffic jams instead of car traffic jams. But that's different, it is different. And certainly less polluting. But the other introductory word I want to say is about my own involvement with this international currency issues, which started 25 years ago, in fact, when the euro was a subject of discussion, debate, analysis, and so forth, and people wanted to know what prospects there would be for internationalization of the euro. And so I wrote a paper with a colleague who subsequently became finance minister of Greece, he's straight, okay. I assure you. That led me further, and then later on in the decade, I wrote a paper about the international role of the euro, which I think has some of the ideas underlying structure of what I want to present to you this evening. And a final introductory word, and that is that you all know the famous Deng Xiaoping saying that it doesn't matter what color the cat is as long as it catches mice. We have an older saying, I believe, and that is, when the cat's away, the mice will play. Well, I know that Governor Zhou of the People's Bank of China is in Washington, and he and I don't entirely agree on these issues, so I will take the liberty of playing a bit this evening. He and I, in fact, were the two lead speakers in a panel on some of these issues, these international monetary system issues, in Paris about 10 days ago, which was a meeting, a G20 organized meeting, that paralleled a meeting 5 years ago, exactly, in Nanjing when China was the president, when France, rather, was in the presidency of the G20, which is what China is now. So, the background, as I say here, is that reasonable people can disagree on some of these issues, and I will try to give you my view. So, what are the issues? Well, I want to start with the conclusions of a London Business School survey. You may have seen some of these data, but I just want to bring them to your attention, and then talk about the policies that China has towards the internationalization of the RMB. As expressed most notably by Governor Zhou, and then ask, well, why you would want to have an international currency. Aren't there some costs to that? And yes, there are, but there are some benefits too. Then I hope this isn't too theoretical, but there are some underlying principles about what determines whether a currency is or becomes an international currency, and I'll talk about that. And then the role of the RMB in the international monetary system now, and the role of special drawing rights, another issue that Governor Zhou made very prominent in a speech that he gave in the spring of 2009, which really started a lot of debate about these issues, and of course started the process of bringing the RMB into the basket of currencies, only four before the RMB, the basket of currencies that constitute the special drawing rights. Does it matter? Well, again, we can disagree about that, perhaps. And then I'll set out why I think there are problems for the RMB developing into an international currency and why it's going to take a long time to do that. The survey says, no, it's not going to take a long time. The LBS survey among, I think, our former students and people affiliated with the school, they're very bullish on this, as you can see from the slide. I think that that's way off the chart, as you'll see. Now, there is some historical evidence that the international currency roles can shift. It hasn't always been the dominance of the U.S. that we've seen since the Bretton Woods Agreement in 1945. If you look back, as far as the U.K. is concerned, even when we had an empire, right, and we're the biggest economic power on the planet, there was competition between the pound sterling, the franc, and the German mark in the period before the gold standard, before 1913. That was a multipolar system. Right? I'm going to come back to multipolarity in a moment. One thing that we've also established, that economic historians have established, is that you can switch back and forth. It doesn't, losing position as an international currency doesn't mean you've lost it forever. And we saw that alternation between the two wars, between sterling and the dollar. Now, what are China's policies? Well, China's policies, as far as I can interpret them, are clear that the world the international monetary system is not a happy place with the dollar dominating as it is, has been for so many years since the war. Therefore, in particular, one should try to expand the role of the special drawing rights and the role of the RMB. So, bring the RMB into the SDR basket and try to expand the global use of both of these currencies. And from that, we see the efforts, for example, to raise the profile and business activities of the RMB in London. And there was an announcement not long ago that also similar activities in Frankfurt, and to promote, in particular, trade invoicing in RMB. And the Chiang Mai initiative, which China very strongly supported, which involves some degree of reserve pooling, in principle. I wonder whether it would work out that way in practice, but the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, the currency swap arrangements that China has concluded with various partners from this region. But why do you want to do this? What's the point? China, there's first some broad considerations. China, and not only China, France shares some of these views, and some other countries too, that especially if you're holding a lot of dollar reserves, as China does, of course, the exchange rate of the dollar makes a big difference to your international investment position, to your foreign assets. And that is a factor in a sense of instability. There is also the fact that has been established fairly recently in a number of papers that the U.S. monetary policy stance has very broad-reaching, very far-reaching, very broad global effects, and that you can't insulate yourself from those effects simply by having flexible exchange rates. The transmission of U.S. monetary policy, because of the dollar's key role in the system, monetary policy impulses are transmitted from the United States elsewhere. The third general principle point is that it is argued, and I have had some say in this argument myself, that the key currency status of the dollar is a factor that has led to the creation of global imbalances, current account, wide current account surpluses and deficits. And in particular, of course, the dollar has had a continuing current account deficit for quite a number of years. So also, there is a geopolitical issue, and it's never been hidden as far as the dollar is concerned, and it shouldn't be hidden as far as the RMB is concerned. Having the issuing a key currency in the international system gives you soft power, and maybe even hard power, in fact, if you can manipulate certain features of the system to your benefit. So that is a consideration for China as well. Then there's the exorbitant privilege, a phrase first used by the French finance minister, as he then was, Giscard d'Estaing, in 1965, referring to two things, really. One was the ability of the U.S. to finance its effect. It wasn't its current account deficit, because it didn't have a current account deficit then, right? It was capital outflows that were, as a couple of years later, another Frenchman wrote a book called Le Défi Américain, The American Challenge, Jean-Jacques Servan-Schreiber, which said, you know, the Americans are buying up everything in sight all over Europe. They're just using those dollars to buy up European firms. How can we cope with this? Well, the answer is that the issuer of the international currency can indeed pile up capital account, capital outflows, in this case, that corresponded to foreign direct investment. Then another part of the exorbitant privilege has been established empirically, that the issuer of the key currency, the dollar in this case, has an advantage in global markets. And you can establish empirically that the U.S. earns excess returns relative to what other countries earn on their foreign investments over a wide range of asset classes. There are disadvantages. I think the main disadvantage, perhaps, is one that we saw in the crisis, that when there is a big international disturbance, money flows straight into the home of the key currency, and that pushes up its exchange rate. And that also means, typically, that its net international investment position deteriorates because its assets are denominated in foreign currencies and it doesn't have many foreign liabilities. So this is what has been called the exorbitant duty. It also involved, as we saw with the Federal Reserve, swap arrangements that had to be brought in. There was a desperate shortage of dollars throughout the world, in particular in Europe, but a need for dollars and dollar liquidity. And so the Fed had to provide that. And it did with a set of swap arrangements that ended up totaling about $600 billion and got a number of US congressmen quite upset. It's not clear that that could happen the next time around. So that is a potential disadvantage. What is it all about, this international currency status? An international currency is an invoicing currency. It's an anchor for currency pegs for other countries. It's an asset currency for both the official and the private sector. It's a vehicle currency in foreign exchange transactions. You don't see foreign exchange transactions but directly between the Brazilian real and the Indian rupee. They go through the dollar because there isn't enough transactions of that kind to make it to make a market that would not have excessive transaction costs. So the final point, and a very important point, is that the world, the issue of the dominant international currency is effectively, or becomes effectively, and we've seen this both for the United Kingdom when it was the dominant currency, when it had the dominant currency, and for the US, the world banker. What does the world banker do? The world banker borrows short term, okay, lends long term. Lends in the form, in particular, of foreign direct investment. And it provides liquidity in crises. So what's different now from the past? The main difference is that trade is no longer the main source of the backing, if you like, for the international currency. It's all about finance and the financial sector. The cross-border financial flows have risen enormously, as you doubtless know. Since 1980, roughly speaking, the curve goes way up, much faster than international trade. And the result of that is a big expansion in various foreign currency markets and cross-border asset result. The cross-border asset movements are part of that financial globalization. So that if you want to look at what determines what makes an international currency, you've got to look at the financial sector. And that's what I'm going to come to in a moment. Currently, where is the RMB? Well, not very far on the way to challenging anybody, really. There are still extensive controls on capital account transactions, so that the RMB as an asset currency is very limited by that. There's a market in RMB, okay, internationally. It's tiny, right? The foreign exchange market. There's the dim sum bond market. Everybody made a big fuss about that for a while. And effectively, what was happening was that corporations were issuing RMB denominated bonds abroad. Because they expected an appreciation of the RMB, but as soon as that one-way bet disappeared, the issuance of dim sum bonds fell quite dramatically. The invoicing, yes, that's in the data. China has succeeded in getting a lot more invoicing of its trade in the RMB. But as I said before, trade flows are much less important than financial flows in this particular game. There are more countries now that are pegging to or following the RMB. Again, this isn't such a big deal. It has some status attached to it, but the economic benefits for China in particular are not huge. There are Chinese swap agreement arrangements, but you know who's going to want RMB in a crisis? That's the point. As long as the American banks, if you like, dominate the global financial system, as long as the dollar is the key currency in the international financial system, the liquidity needs will have to be met with dollars, not RMB. And then there's the entry into the SDR basket. Now, what does that matter, the SDR basket? Not a lot. It's nice. It's a good vanity project, as it were. That's a bit, maybe a bit harsh, but still. The SDR, what does it do? Not a lot, you know? It's not an invoicing currency. It's not an anchor for currency pegs. It's not a vehicle currency in the foreign exchange markets. It's not a private asset currency. Nobody issues SDR-denominated bonds. In fact, it's just one of several official reserve currencies that has the special feature that the IMF can create it on a vote of the membership. Right? And It can, when, and that's what happened in the spring of 2009 when it was thought that extra global liquidity was needed. But that has to be that can't be allocated to the countries that need the liquidity. It has to be allocated according to quota shares in the fund. So now, is the RMB a serious alternative to the dollar in the international financial system? Well, I think not, and for several reasons. And not in that 5 to 10 year horizon that the LBS survey focused on. First, you'd have to get rid of restrictions on capital account transactions. Full convertibility, no buts about it, right? No qualifications, has to be full convertibility. Second, you'd have to have here large, liquid, efficient markets, in particular for government securities, but also for corporate securities. Those are the assets that international investors want to be in, right? Especially for short to medium term transactions. You need efficient markets, spot foreign exchange markets, for between the RMB and a wide range of currencies. And again, that doesn't happen overnight. Right? That will take long, long time to develop. You've got to have serious foreign exchange derivatives markets, you've got to have serious interest rate swap markets, so that people can hedge their exposures, and you've got to have these government security markets fully open to non-residents. You need a well-functioning financial sector institutional infrastructure. And that is developing very slowly here. I quite understand that. I'm not saying it should be pushed faster, honestly. These are tricky issues and tricky problems, and they can't be solved overnight. But indeed, they can't, and that's why it's going to take quite a long time. The final point on this slide is, I think, one of the most important. You need legal certainty. You need foreign users of the RMB to know that a transaction will be is underpinned by a legal agreement, a contract that can be enforced, and be enforced without hassle by well-functioning commercial courts. So that is, I think, a major issue, and that's going to take time here too. What else do you need? Coordination of domestic financial regulation with regulators elsewhere, because otherwise you're going to get regulatory arbitrage, and you're going to get problems with different macroprudential environments in different countries. You need to have a way of building up foreign-held RMB balances. The RMB as a global liquid asset, right? And how do you do that? Well, there are only two ways. You can run a current account deficit, and that's not likely for China for quite some time, huh? Or you can do what the US did in the 1960s in particular, which was lending abroad a lot. Now, China has been doing much more of that, but it's, again, the numbers are not yet huge. Then finally, could the People's Bank of China act as the lender of last resort, not just domestically, but internationally, as the Fed did in the autumn of 2008? Is China ready, is China willing to play that World Banker role of maturity transformation that substitutes for the financial institutions in countries where they're not very well developed and where you need that kind of external, if you like, intermediation. So, bottom line, last slide, very simple. The changes that are required to bring the RMB into the realm of a serious major international currency. I'm not even saying challenging the dollar, right? I'm saying, if you like, challenge the euro, assuming that the euro stays together, challenge the euro, which is number two, that is going to take a very long time. All those things that I pointed out in those last couple of slides have to be done, and they're not going to be easy. So, thank you very much.
It's been a very privilege for me to have a one-on-one interview with Professor Portes this afternoon, and we are going to air that interview tomorrow. And I know that in the afternoon you talked with the official from the China Banking Regulatory Commission. So how was that meeting going?
I was very impressed. I say that openly and sincerely. I was very impressed. This was the director of the Department of Prudential Supervision of the China Bank Regulatory Commission. And he had just come back from a Financial Stability Board meeting in Tokyo. And he gave us a brief introduction, and then it just went around the table. And our executive MBA students are wonderful at asking good questions. And they didn't give me much of a chance, really, at the end. But that was fine. His responses were open, detailed, hugely knowledgeable, and gave you the feeling that there was really, as I say, the institutions themselves have to develop a lot, but I was impressed that the regulatory framework, at least, is going very much in the right direction. There are many things to be done still, but it's clear that international standards are the name of the game, and China is moving towards those international standards.
As you said, that some of the officials are already, you know, trying to push something forward, but there is still very strong challenges facing all those kind of reforms. And the AmCham, the American Chamber of Commerce China, releases a paper said the business conducting business here, American business conducting business here in China, their major frustration is the misinterpretation or the vague interpretation of rule of laws, rule and some regulations. And that's another thing you touch upon about the legal certainty of the currency. How China will internationalize its currency depends on this issue. Can you elaborate more on that?
Well, I think, actually, I'll give you one example that is really rather troubling for international investors now, and that is the way a particular judge in New York handled the case of Argentina and Argentina's debt and the holdout creditors that were pressing for a settlement and so forth. I'm not going to go into detail about that, but it turned out that this judge was a maverick, right? He was a rogue judge, and he got angry about Argentina, and he completely changed the nature of the interpretation of sovereign immunity and the so-called pari passu clause in sovereign debt contracts. That is extremely disturbing. It is very rare. U.S. courts, the New York commercial courts are very good. I think, in many ways, I have to say, the London commercial courts are probably even better. And there you have legal certainty, clarity, you have a lot of people, both the judges and the lawyers, who know the law very well. You have enforceability of contracts. And yes, those are things that China still has to develop.
If we were, say, you were just saying that if RMB is going to be internationalized, the currency, it takes as far as decades to go. But if Chinese currency, the RMB, were to become one of the major currencies, let's say a tripolar system, do you see the international monitoring system be more stabilized or have more risks?
There are conflicting considerations here, and there's a fair amount of academic literature out there. I contributed a bit myself. It's not obvious that it's more stable or less stable. You can, I think, reasonably say on the basis of theory that exchange rates would probably be more volatile than they are now, mm-hmm. right? Because portfolio substitution would be easier. You've got three alternatives rather than just two, if you like, okay, for a major international investment. That's a possibility. The second is, would capital flows be more or less volatile? And there again, you can argue with three different sources of capital exports and capital imports, with three different sources you have a diversification, and that might be stabilizing. And this disproportionate role of the U.S. monetary policy in the system might be mitigated considerably. So that's a plus. On the other hand, you could say that there might be more competition in international capital flows between the issuing, the major reserve areas, and that could pose problems. So I'm not convinced. I know that Governor Zhou feels strongly about this, that the multipolar system would be more stable. You could also make the argument, and maybe this is one that is fairly unambiguous, that with three major international currencies, there's an extra source of global liquidity, right? And some people, not me, and I actually disagree with some of these arguments, but some people believe that we're facing prospectively a shortage of global liquidity because the U.S. won't be able to issue enough government securities to back up dollar reserves. I don't see that, really. I certainly don't see that we have a shortage of global liquidity now. We did in the crisis, yes, but crisis, we had lots of things fell apart. I'm not as moved by this argument as some people are, but it's a serious argument.
You mentioned that to internationalize the currency, it needs even decades. But according to the survey you conducted, some people are
I didn't conduct it.
No, that you're referring to, actually, people are quite sometimes confident about the internationalization of RMB, why there is such a big gap between the two concepts.
That is an interesting question. Wishful thinking? Possible. Being convinced by the hype? Because there's a lot of hype. Mm-hmm. Even our Minister of Finance, our Chancellor of the Exchequer, has been one of the people who has promoted this hype, if you like. Mm-hmm. And we have events in London all the time celebrating the next steps in the RMB role in the city and blah, blah, blah. Come on.
We were very busy, you know, covering the stories when President Xi Jinping paid a state visit to the United Kingdom last year. And as we mentioned in our previous interview, you said that the role that London will play for the internationalization of the RMB will be more symbolic, or rather than...
I what I meant was that all this stuff about issuing banks in London, issuing RMB-denominated securities, you know, there's got to be a demand for those securities, excuse me, right? Who's going to want to buy them? Mm-hmm. How much demand is there going to be? If there's demand, well, yes, then the banks that are doing this will make some money off it. But I don't see, honestly, that this is not going to be a major part of the business of the City of London over the next decade or two.
You've mentioned in your presentation about the China's, you know, being admitted in the SDR basket. Although you are saying that it doesn't make quite a big change for the Chinese currency internationalization, but you know, we here in the Chinese media, we have a different rhetoric about everything, different from what you've been saying. So can you elaborate more about that? Because you know, sometimes people down here and business people conducting here and even the government are giving a totally different rhetoric.
Hey, that's what academics are supposed to do, isn't it? Challenge the orthodoxy, challenge the conventional wisdom. I don't know whether Andrew would agree that that's what they pay us for, but at least that's what we think we're doing, right? With our research and with our analysis. And I'm sorry, I understand it is clearly of symbolic importance. Mm-hmm. But what I'm saying is that the symbolic importance, set that aside, look at the underlying substance. The SDR is not a big deal. It is a big deal. And, you know, much more important, in my view, would be that the Chinese quota in the International Monetary Fund would be doubled, say. That would make sense. Absolute sense, and that would make a difference. As it stands, the fund is dominated very much by the United States. Mm-hmm. And it's that it should not be. So, but that's a battle that even getting a small increase in the quotas was a, took 5 years after it was agreed to get it past the U.S. Congress. So it's not going to happen, not in a long time anyway.
You know, one way the Chinese government is trying to get itself more integrated into the SDR basket, and another way, the Chinese government is actually starting some new cross-border multinational financial institutions, like you said, the AIIB, mm-hmm. the New Development Bank, and a lot of initiatives like that, including the one that you mentioned, the Chiang Mai Initiative. Mm-hmm. So what do you read from this? One way, you are still in closely interacting with the SDR currencies, and in another way, starting their own business from the side. How do you read from this?
I'm not sure what you mean by closely interacting with the SDR. you're in the accounting basket, mm-hmm. right? Well, you know, what actual good does that do? I'm trying to suggest that not a lot. On the other hand, and I think this is good, the regional financial arrangements. And this is one case where the UK did the right thing, even though it got the Americans very upset, when we took the lead in getting countries from outside the region to participate in the AIIB. The AIIB is an excellent initiative, and of course, it has to be done well, run well, but I have a fair amount of confidence in that. And just today or yesterday, there was an item about close collaboration between the AIIB and the World Bank, mm-hmm. absolutely essential. And it looks like that's in train, it's happening. So I think that is very, very positive. And if people say, just another way of extending China's influence, well, you know, fair enough, why not? China's got the resources, got the money, and to the extent that it can use that in a constructive way in the region, that's great.
You know, the one thing that China launched AIIB, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, as long as together with the Belt and Road Initiative, some people argue that China is wanting to spend some of its massive foreign reserve through this kind of massive investment projects. Mm-hmm. So do you read that the Chinese government feel vulnerable by only holding their foreign assets in US dollars? And will the internationalization of the RMB help to alleviate such, you know, uncertainty and fear?
I don't know about fear, but uncertainty, yes. Yes, of course, that, absolutely right. But the fact is that it's like when they asked the gangster, Willie Sutton, why do you rob banks? He said, that's where the money is, you know? and China's got the money. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, let's hope it's not going to get robbed. Although there are some issues, and we talked about that this afternoon, there are some issues about trying to keep better control over the Chinese firms' investments abroad that might be bordering on the reckless. So I don't think, you know, I think that there's no reason for concern there. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I think I'm good for me, and we can leave the questions to our audiences. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and introduce yourself briefly and ask your question. Thank you.
There are roving mics, I believe.
Do we have any questions? Please raise your hand. Okay, the gentleman over there. Thank you.
Hi, it's Andrew White, London Business School. Richard, thanks for that presentation. It was amazing. You mentioned that the time frame being decades before the RMB becomes an international currency. In your mindset, how long that period really be? Decades is quite an open-ended word.
Okay. Am I not allowed a little bit of freedom of movement here?
Are we talking single decades? Yeah, are we talking multi?
The old saying, you can give them a forecast or you can give them a date, but never give them a date and a forecast. I forecast that it will happen. Can I stop there? No, I think we're talking about 20 to 30 years. If I have to give you a date, right? I think that's about the kind of horizon I'm thinking of. Yeah.
Other questions? Okay. Thank you.
Richard, thank you for the great presentation. It was a bit surprising for me, actually. I was thinking that your opinion is that RMB will be internationalized soon. Do you expect turbulence in the nearest time in China securities market due to slowing of development and not perfect regulation so far?
Turbulence in the Chinese securities market.
Yeah. Due to regulation issues and slowing.
Like the turbulence we saw in the Shanghai market last year.
Yes. Jumping up and down.
Mm-hmm. And yes.
Thank you.
Okay. There are two. Of course, you all know the two major, so it seemed anyway, major events last year were first the huge run-up in prices in Shanghai, equity prices, and then the crash. And the other was the slight loosening of the exchange rate band, which was interpreted as a devaluation of the RMB and the beginning, perhaps, of a progressive major devaluation of the RMB. I think myself, I'm fairly clear on this, that that there was encouragement from the authorities, and I say the authority, when I say the authorities, I do not mean the technocrats, right? There was encouragement from the authorities to invest in the Shanghai market. You're going to get rich that way. People did get rich that way, so it seemed. Many people did, and in fact, some still are. And what happened was there, you know, the word bubble is used much too often, but in this context, but this was a real bubble. Okay? It was driven entirely by speculative expectations. And as soon as those expectations got broken, then the bubble pops and you have a crash. Okay, that happens. It happens everywhere. And it wouldn't be so exciting or interesting if it weren't for the fact that the way in which they tried to deal with it was ham-handed, was really awkward, and suggested a lack of expertise, knowledge, etc. We know about circuit breakers. 1987, U.S. Equities market crashed, and that began a lot of work on how you can have circuit breakers in equity markets, okay? The technology was there just for the taking, okay? And it wasn't taken. Instead, you had a lot of rather crude moves to try to keep the prices up, which were just a mistake. So that, now, would that happen again? I honestly don't know whether the authorities have learned from that experience. I do not know, and we won't know until the issue arises again. With the currency there, with the exchange rate there, it was not a matter of instability in the markets or anything. It was a matter of really poor communication, very poor communication of what the authorities were, what they were trying to do, it was a pity. People concluded, as I said, there might be a major devaluation. There's not going to be a major devaluation. So I think as far as stability of the market, look, the other thing, and I'll finish this on this point, the other thing is that thin markets are typically less stable, more volatile. These markets are, as I said in my talk, still thin, right? You expect more volatility. You will get it, right? What's needed is to develop those markets and get the liquidity, get the depth, and so on and so forth.
Okay. Other questions? Okay, lady.
Hi, my name is Yuan from the Financial Times. It seems that the Chinese authorities are trying to pursue two conflicting objectives, to internationalize the RMB while also keeping control of the capital account. And I wonder, in recent months, those two have come very much into conflict with it being said that the fear of capital outflows is what's driving the tightening of the capital account. I wonder, what do you think, what conditions need to be present for this fear of the outflows to start to go away and for liberalization to start to happen? Because it seems to me that although China is slowing relative to itself, it's still a very good bet in terms of growth compared to the rest of the world. Where else can you see 6% real growth? So what do you think needs to be happen for the conditions to be ripe for capital account liberalization and lack of outflows?
Okay, I got it. It's a very important issue. I said it's a necessary condition, though not a sufficient condition, for the serious emergence of the RMB as an international currency. But it certainly is a necessary condition. Now, start from what we observed last year. We haven't been observing it this year. The very big capital outflow. If you actually go into the details of the composition of that capital outflow, you find that a substantial proportion of it was Chinese firms buying back or buying out their foreign dollar debt. Okay? That's just a stock movement. That's not a flow. That isn't anything to worry about long term. It just reduces their liabilities in foreign currency. And the net international position, investment position of China doesn't change, right? So the question then is, the broader question, I think the data, analysis of the data suggests that most of those outflows were not, say, households, individuals, financial institutions fleeing. Capital flight from China. So some of it, and indeed paying back the corporate debt in dollars, may have been in expectation of renminbi depreciation. Those expectations may have changed now. Mm-hmm. Certainly the capital outflow figures appear to have fallen very considerably. So why be afraid, though? Well, because this is dangerous territory. Many countries have discovered that free capital movement, and sometimes more free capital inflows, the freedom of capital inflow than outflow, because that capital inflow can be hot money. There isn't much hot money that has come into China. A little bit when there was an expectation of a one-way appreciation of the RMB. Some of the capital inflow then would have been speculation on that appreciation, but I think that is no longer a one-way bet, and so the dangers are more symmetrical. That said, there are dangers in free capital flows. We know that. We've seen it in country after country. Whether it's the inflows that build up hot money that then leaves at the first provocation, or whether it's the ease of actually taking money out that makes it possible for that capital account deterioration. And a lot of people have put forward, I think, good arguments for limitations on capital flows. There is, for example, the argument that can be used as a macroprudential tool, that if you think that capital inflows may be sparked by, and this is the referring to the research I mentioned before, capital inflows sparked by, say, a U.S. monetary easing, right? if you think that that is hot, a lot of that's hot money, well, maybe you should stop some of it coming in, right? Because that has inflationary, expansionary, et cetera, consequences. And that will force your central bank, put your central bank actually in a very difficult position. That's why the Brazilians complained bitterly at quantitative easing, that this was a currency war, right? Well, what they really meant and what was happening was that there was this big capital flow into Brazil because of U.S. quantitative easing, monetary policy shock, and that pushed up the value of the currency, right? But value of the real made them less competitive, okay? At the same time, if you want to combat that, what do you have to do? Well, you have to intervene in the foreign exchange market. What does that mean? That means typically inflationary pressures. Okay? So, and Brazil certainly didn't need that. So there was a case, and they did try taxing those inflows. It wasn't a very successful capital control, it turns out. Maybe direct controls are the best way to do it. And to some extent, the IMF has come around to this position. So I think bottom line is, I would be, fortunately, all my life I've been an academic. I've never taken a policy job. It gives you, you're totally free. But if it were me, right, I would be very careful in the Chinese circumstances about the rate of liberalizing the capital account. There are some very good arguments for making that slow, even if it means sacrificing a few years on the timetable of the RMB becoming an international currency.
Any questions from the audience? I have one more question. Tomorrow will be the release date from the National Bureau of Statistics about the first quarter GDP. And we know that the National Development Reform Commission, the China's top economic planner, has announced that the power consumption is rising and the inflation pressure will be eased in the second quarter probably. So do you see there are some silver lining for the Chinese slowing economic development?
What you said about power consumption raises an issue that that I spoke about with our students in the EMBA course a couple of days ago, and that is the claims that the data about Chinese growth are being misrepresented, or being falsified, maybe even, or miscalculated, or whatever. You shouldn't really trust them. Why? Because how can you report 6.9% growth in 2015 when electricity consumption didn't go up much, when freight shipments didn't go up very much, and so on. Those measures, and the Prime Minister Li actually is associated, used to be his favorite index was based on a few indicators like that, no?
Yeah, and the jobs, jobs created.
And jobs is a different story, but freight shipments and electricity consumption and so forth, those are indicators of what's happening in the old economy, in the industrial sector. And yes, the industrial growth has slowed down and will continue to slow down. But service sector growth has taken off. And that is exactly what all the Western commentators who say, oh, it's a crash that's coming, China is going to be a disaster, blah, 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 blah. And the same people who told you 10 years ago that China had to rebalance, get out of heavy industry into a modern economy, services and all that. That's what China has done. And the data show it in the past decade. And yes, the industrial production data, industrial production is still going up, but yes, the rate of growth will necessarily slow down. Mm-hmm. That was the whole point. That's exactly what should happen. So I think that data issues aside, every country you go to, I was in India in December, and I got an earful from Indian economists about how you shouldn't trust the Indian GDP data, and there's all that. My own guess, right, is that China will probably show 6.5 this year, and will sort of gradually tail down to around 6 in aggregate for the next several years. Mm-hmm. And that is not very bad. If people say, oh, but it used to be 10%, and you're going, yeah, right, you can't keep going at 10%. You couldn't ever. Whatever Goldman Sachs said, you know, China. It was never realistic. It was always in the cards that there would be this slowdown. That doesn't mean, and then we get into an issue that we didn't actually touch on in the interview this afternoon, but which you mentioned, and that is the middle income trap, mm-hmm. right? The story that, hey, it's very difficult to get beyond the level that China is at now. Well, I think there's really, there are some cases like that, but there are others where countries have managed to maintain a solid growth rate, and that growth rate here, henceforth, has to be based on expansion of services, expansion of personal consumption, which means shift of incomes towards wage earners, and so forth. That's the kind of rebalancing. It's happened partly already, mm-hmm. and I believe it can continue successfully.
One last question, and we are talking about that the second largest economy in the world will move forward in a relatively mid to high development speed. Which directions you suggest us look into? Which sectors specifically? You mentioned about shifting from industry more to services sector. So to be more specifically, which sectors you see China has an advantage relative to them?
That gets us into picking winners, you know? And we learned a while back in the United Kingdom, or at least we thought we did anyway, having, whether it's officials or academics, trying to pick winners specific sectors even, and putting money, directing investment towards those sectors or whatever, that is all too often a losing game. Mm-hmm. That's what markets are for. I mean, markets have lots of flaws, and I am one of the first to point out those flaws when they're there. But sure, you should be putting money into education. You should be putting money into infrastructure. There are plenty of opportunities still for very productive infrastructure mm-hmm. investment in China, in schools, for example. You may not need more airports. Your rate of airport construction is really terrifying. But there are still important infrastructure areas. So there's a lot. There's a lot that government can do. But the rest, this choice of which should it be? Mm-hmm. Constructing more cinemas because the demand is clearly there? Well, that's right. Okay, for a while. And then you'll find that, hey, you've met the demand. Demand's not going to go very fast anymore. And then you'll go into other things. Tourism is clearly an area, domestic tourism, where there are enormous possibilities. Mm-hmm. And that makes people better off. It also makes jobs. Mm-hmm. And so on. But to say, what should the state do mm-hmm. to favor particular areas? I think that's very tricky.
One last question. The Chinese
I
have a lot of last questions.
No, that's fine.
Okay.
That's fine. No.
One last question for good.
No.
The Chinese government claim they will let a market to play a decisive role in resources allocation. I'm quoting. So how do you see that? Mm-hmm. How do you see the Chinese government? Is it behaving like what they claim to do? And do you still believe the huge power of the market? Or you think that the government should play a role in fine-tuning? We use fine-tuning here with the market.
As I say, there are many areas. We are very familiar with the areas where markets need to be regulated. where there are externalities, where there are competition issues, where there is there are pollution issues, and so forth. Regulation, sometimes taxation, is the appropriate way to deal with these things. But for as far as intervention in the economy is concerned, my favorite intervention would be to get close down some of the zombie enterprises, right? That is politically very difficult. And it requires, and this is very promising, it requires financial support for the people who are put out of jobs. And I understand that it's proposed that 100 billion
RMB, yeah.
RMB be put into and precisely that kind of financial support this year. And that, it seems to me, is a very promising realization that, you know, you've got to get rid of some of these unproductive, inefficient activities. And I think that's, if I were thinking about priorities for government, well, you've just asked me to, and I've said, that would be my priority.
Okay. Thank you so much, Professor. And thank you for participation in our first Beijing event for Leading Minds. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.